Hello and welcome to this presentation about undergraduate admissions at the School of Physics and Astronomy at Cardiff University. My name is Chris North, I'm the Director of Recruitment and Admissions here in Physics, and I'm one of a number of people you might meet. There's Annabel Cartwright, the Director of Undergraduate Studies, Sarah Reagan, Undergraduate Admissions Tutor, and then Dave, Jess and Paulina, who make up the Student Services team. If you're looking for a physics degree at university, you're probably looking at the location, the facilities, the research that takes place, and the teaching and support. The aim of this presentation is to touch on all of those things. Cardiff is a very green city. There are a lot of parks around, particularly things like Bute Park behind the castle. There are even lots of green areas close to physics at the front of the museum, and in fact, just even around the back of some of our buildings. It's also a city that's full of culture, arts and sport. There's a lot of Welsh culture here, of course, and then sports in right in the centre of the city centre. We've got the Principality Stadium, previously known as the Millennium Stadium, which hosts rugby matches and an awful lot of events at all times of the year. The city really comes alive when, if there are big crowds allowed, there are lots of people watching rugby matches, for example. It's a university within reach of, or it's a city within reach of beaches and mountains. So we have the Brecon Beacons up to the north, we have beaches down to the south and west, and of course there's West Wales, a beautiful place to go and visit, only a couple of hours away. We're well connected to the rest of the UK as well. We're not far from the M4, and the train network, we're only a couple of hours from, or less than 2 hours from London. You get all of that for a low cost of living. So somewhere between £300 and £400 per month, when we ask our students typically what they pay, that's about what they pay per month. And that's very low for a capital city. The School of Physics and Astronomy is located just a few minutes' walk from the centre of Cardiff. So we're very, very well placed. We're a little way from the main buildings, but only about 10 minutes walk or so from the main building, the Students' Union, and what is coming in 2021, the Centre for Student Life. So we're very well placed with them and with accommodation blocks that are close by as well. All first-year students are guaranteed accommodation. The vast majority of that is within university halls. Accommodation blocks owned by the university. There's a list of preferences that are given, typically around July time. Those with who have Cardiff as their firm offer, the firm acceptance are given priority over those who are insurance, and then finally those who come through clearing. The cost of the accommodation varies. It can be from around £4,000 a year to around £6,000 a year. That's for September to June. Details are on the website, and it varies between accommodation blocks because of the different facilities that are available. Some accommodation blocks have evening meal costs, which can be included as well. The closest blocks to physics are Sangenith Hall and Gordon Hall. They are just a few minutes away. The largest accommodation block is Tallybont, which has a number of different blocks within it. So Tallybont North, Tallybont South, Tallybont Court, Tallybont Gate, and so on. About 1,200 rooms in total. And that's right by a park and a social centre. That's about a 30-minute walk from physics. So you can clear the cobwebs on the way into your lectures. After your first year, then most students go and live out in private accommodation. There are an awful lot of rooms available in shared housing, so what you might call traditional student digs, which are available for somewhere around £300 to £350 per month. When we ask our students typically what they pay, it depends exactly what you want. In terms of accommodation blocks and so on, then there are hundreds of rooms available in private halls. Those are typically more expensive, but they do include an awful lot of other facilities. Bills are included, of course, and then things like private gyms, games rooms, cinemas in some of them as well. So do look around for accommodation from your second year. The majority of students do live in that shared housing with a group of friends they've met on their course or who they lived with in the first year or they met through a social society or whatever. Research here in the School of Physics and Astronomy is in six main research groups. First of all, there's the condensed matter and photonics research group, looking at the interaction of light and matter and how it changes and lets us build innovative devices. Then we have astronomy, studying the formation of the universe, of galaxies, of stars and even planets. We have the Astronomy Instrumentation Group, designing instrumentation for future telescopes, both down on the ground and up in space. We have the Brain Imaging Group, who look at the science, the physics behind MRI scanners and what that tells us about the brain, how to analyse that data. We have the Gravity Exploration Institute, who are part of the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, that 1,000-strong international collaboration that's been detecting gravitational waves, among other things. And then finally, we have the Physics Education Research Group, who look at making sure our education that we deliver here and elsewhere is of the highest quality. In terms of the physics and the medical physics research, we do an awful lot about lasers, photonics, quantum devices, magnetic devices, and so on. And that is in a theoretical sense and also a practical sense. So predicting how devices should and will work, as well as building them and testing them. These are often, or almost always, involve some sort of semiconductor of some sort. And so we have an awful lot of experience of designing, building, testing semiconductor devices and fabricating them on site, including at the Institute for Compound Semiconductors, which is part of a South Wales hub of semiconductor technology being developed as we speak. One particular research group works in diamond devices. We have a diamond foundry here on site, which uses the properties of diamond. It's, for example, it's high thermal conductivity and it's very low electrical conductivity. You can also put impurities in and turn it into a semiconductor, which is very useful. So using the properties of these materials, for example, diamond, on a nano scale rather than the bulk properties to develop devices. We collaborate with the Cardiff University Brain Research Imaging Centre, or CUBRIC, in the Brain Imaging Group, developing the physics behind analysis of MRI scanner data and other things as well. Other medical physicists work on various diagnosis and treatment technologies that rely on physics to work. In terms of the relationship between the two, then we have the Biophotonics Group, who use photonics, that's the interaction of light and matter, to do things like treat and diagnose diseases, and they can look at using lasers to study biological materials, biological samples, and so on. And we also have a group who look at physics education research to make sure the education we're delivering is of the highest quality and using the best practices. That stretches just to higher education, to our students, but also down into some schools engagement work, working with schools in South Wales and further beyond. Further out in the universe, our astronomy group works in a very, very broad range of scales, from the formation of planets and stars out to galaxies and how they've evolved over cosmic time, and even to the universe itself, the cosmology, looking at the microwave, but the cosmic microwave background, the baby picture, the afterglow of the Big Bang, if you like. So that's done on a number of avenues. So that's the theoretical side of things, but also the experimental, the observational side of things. We have astronomers who are experts in observing star-forming regions and galaxies near and far, as well as colleagues who are simulating those in computers and comparing that with the observations that are taken. We also have a group working on astronomy instrumentation, and that's taking designing the next generation of instruments for satellites, for ground-based telescopes, and so on as well. That group not only taking stuff for telescopes for looking out into space, but also looking down onto ground to look down at the Earth and also its atmosphere, looking at climate change and so on. That technology has also been developed for all sorts of other purposes down here on planet Earth. The General Relativity Group, the Gravitational Physics Group, is now called the Gravity Exploration Institute and is part of the LIGO team, the 1,000-strong international collaboration, which is the LIGO and Virgo teams that have made these well-known detections of gravitational waves from merging black holes and neutron stars. And we have physicists here who work on the theoretical simulations of Einstein's equations, on analysing the data from these detectors to pull out these very, very weak signals, and also on the next generation of detectors and developing those. So in many fields of our research, it is those three pillars, though, that observation, that theoretical prediction, and then the development of instrumentation for the future. So overall, we have a wide variety of degree programmes. We have physics, physics with astronomy, astrophysics, and physics with medical physics. It is a modular system of modules, and the choices depend on which options, or the options you get depend on which flavour of physics you're doing. There is a core year in the first year where the options are almost set for you, and that means that at the end of your first year, you can change to any other choice of degree flavour. The modules, there's the equivalent of 12 per year. Some are double modules or more, so it's, there's normally slightly fewer than that, with exams taken in January and June between 1 and 3 hours long. About half the mark that you get at the end of your degree will be from continual assessments, that's coursework. The other half is from exams. And that's a relatively low percentage of exam grade, and that's because we acknowledge that sitting an exam is not the only way or the best way necessarily of judging whether you are a good physicist. There are many other better ways of measuring that in different circumstances through these coursework. The year one is really that transition from school to university. It's all about getting fast feedback, so these small group tutorials, to really make sure that you're getting all the support you need and we're doing all the things that you need us to do. And over the course of your degree, the optional modules grow, so you can really tailor what you're doing to your own choices. There are many options as well as which flavour you're doing. You can choose the BSc or the MPhys course, or for some options, the professional placement. And because you can change those, the MPhys or BSc at the end of your second year, and the professional placement, you make that decision at the start of your second year. It's not advisable to apply for more than one course here in physics and astronomy, because you can change that either when you enrol or at the end of your first year or the end of your second year. As you go through. So there is continual flexibility in the degree course that you're taking. Our teaching facilities are many and varied. We have lecture theatres. Our teaching uses a variety of techniques. Now, our standard lectures are maybe 6 to 8 hours per week for a typical undergraduate course. So that's about that amount of talking during social distancing and so on. That will obviously vary, but that's under normal operating procedures, it will be 6 to 8 hours per week. That doesn't mean that it's 6 to 8 hours solid, of course. That's normally broken up. There's exercise classes, there's online exercises that people do, there are tutorials, there are laboratories. The lectures actually form a relatively small part of the delivery. In total, it's about 16 to 18 hours of timetable time per week, and the lectures are a relatively small part of that. Exercise classes are normally an hour or two long, and that gives you a chance to talk to a lecturer about work you're trying to catch up with. Laboratory classes are normally one afternoon a week for the experimental lab, and then when you're doing computing labs, again, it's typically about an afternoon a week for those as well, so about 4 hours a week for that. There are weekly meetings with a personal tutor in the first year, and those are typically in small groups of maybe around 5 students. That supports the learning in those modules. It supports the personal development of students when they first arrive. And over the course of the degree, while year one is that crucial year for transitioning from school to university, the support in that sense, that scaffolding is slowly removed as students get much better at supporting their own learning and developing their own techniques for how to learn and research. In the later years, then you'll have regular meetings with your project supervisor for your individual research projects. So these are a very, very popular part of our degree, and they're linked with research groups in the universities. Throughout all of this, there are transferable skills such as programming. We use the Python programming language, giving presentations, writing reports, all sorts of things that are so important for all manner of careers in the future. Project work that students do gives a real chance to do research with some of the school's world-class research facilities. The research topics that are part of the third and fourth year projects cross the whole spectrum of research that takes place in the school, from astronomy to gravitation to condensed matter physics to brain imaging, and even outreach and engagement and higher and physics education research and so on. Students generally really like these projects because it gives them something to really get their teeth into and to test the skills that they've developed over the years of their degree. In the fourth year, it's a major project. It counts for about half your mark in that fourth year, so it's a fairly significant part of your degree. That's for students doing the MPhys options. For the BSc and the MPhys, there's a third year project, which again is a reasonable chunk of your third year, slightly smaller, and still gives a chance to do some research with a research group to analyse some data, to have critical analysis skills, and to develop those presentation and report writing skills. Modules in the first year are probably not dissimilar to what you've seen at A level or equivalent. So things like mechanics, electricity, magnetism, maths. Computational skills is probably new, but we don't require any knowledge of computational skills when you start. We teach it from the ground up. We also have modules in planet Earth. Experimental physics is the labs, of course, and then some medical physics options for how the human body works, and astrophysics. Now, the keys on all these pages are that the yellowish stars, the gold colour stars, are compulsory modules, and the dark blue stars are optional modules. In the first year, you can see that there's a lot of gold there. That means that the modules are basically all compulsory. There's relatively little choice for what students can do, and that means that at the end of your first year you can still switch which flavour of physics you're doing, be that physics, physics with astronomy, astrophysics, or medical physics, because that first year is core. The pictures on the left show some of the lab activities taking place, in particular one of the fun activities at the end of the first semester with developing what's sometimes called a Rube Goldberg machine to use bits of old junk and physics equipment to move a ball bearing from one end of a lab bench to another without touching it. In the second year, there are some new concepts come in. So this is the first half of the modules. This is a lot of the core modules in fields and flow, so fluid mechanics, in thermal and statistical physics, in optics, quantum mechanics, proper look at quantum mechanics, and then also condensed matter physics, the thing that drives the technology behind phones and computers that you're no doubt watching this on right now. There's also more programming, structured programming, to develop those computational skills. Of course, there's practical physics, and that's split between the physics side and the astronomy side, depending on which flavour of physics you're doing, and that will be based in the lab or based in the astronomy lab, learning how to take and analyse astronomical data. The practical labs also use some of the skills that you built up from the first year. So the computational skills in analysing data and develop and fitting functions to it to get the best fit parameters out, for example. So it's all about developing those practical skills. The labs are slightly longer, they might be working in pairs, and you write up one of them in a much longer report in the second year as well. That's not all in the second year. The second year also involves synoptic modules, so synoptic physics and synoptic astrophysics, which are group modules based on problems that are unseen, but using knowledge that you developed in the first year and the first part of the second year. There's electronic instrumentation, stars and their planets. So these are modules that are obviously linked to astronomy in some senses, and then electronics. There's electricity in the human body and radiation and medical diagnosis. These are medical physics modules, and some of the pictures on the left show an X-ray scanner, show an X-ray image, and then the bottom right image is showing a lab taking place, which is developing EEGs. So students are building monitors and testing them on each other. There's also a module for those taking the professional placement course for building up experience in writing CVs and applying for placements and so on. In the third year, then, you'll see there's a lot less gold on this page, there's much more blue. The courses are more specialised, there's a lot more choice. So we focus on the core modules of atomic and nuclear physics and particle physics and special relativity, but beyond that, it's much more optional for most students. You can really see the difference in the table on the right between the astrophysics and the physics with astronomy options. So there's options for physics and astronomy can pick those astrophysics modules or some of the other modules in straight physics as well. So there's a lot more choice, and there are more modules below the fold in a second. In astronomy, there's study of galaxies, of high energy astrophysics, of cosmology, so learning about astrophysics on all sorts of scales, but also on how that information is detected, that electromagnetic radiation is picked up by telescopes, by satellites and so on, how that works. And how that contributes to our knowledge of the universe. There's also modules on environmental physics, and of course, with climate change being such a big challenge that the human race is facing, then Learning about the impact of physics on that, the importance of physics in that, is very important. In terms of other modules, there's theoretical physics and statistical mechanics. These also are then complemented by modules on semiconductor devices and its applications, and laser physics and nonlinear optics. These are really looking at the devices that are driving the world, powering the internet and the modern world, but then also commercializing those and taking those further in terms of a commercial sense, patents and so on, and how that works is a module that groups will take technologies and design commercializing options for some of those technologies. In the medical physics side of things, there's work on ultrasound, on radiation for medical therapy, on digital medical imaging, and these work with a broad range of medical physicists, and that can be on nuclear medicine, it can be on radiotherapy, it can be on MRI scanners, and so on. An awful lot of physics in medicine these days. In the fourth year for MPhys students, there's a lot of choice, and they're really getting into the nitty-gritty of our research. So in the astronomy side of things, then there are modules on instrumentation for astronomy on energy and gas in interstellar space. So these are looking at our development of instrumentation for developing new telescope instruments to go on ground-based telescopes, on satellites, whatever. But then also what they show us about the energy and gas in interstellar space from stars forming and planets forming and so on. In the general relativity side of things, we have an introduction to general relativity, Einstein's theory from just over 100 years ago, then also advanced general relativity and gravitational waves for those who really want to see the up-to-date information from things like LIGO and Virgo that our research groups are so heavily involved in. We also have modules on physics of the early universe, which is again looking at cosmology and how that the physics of the early universe drive the way the universe looks today. More broader than astronomy, we have a module on physics and reality. That's almost like a philosophical module in some senses. And then a data analysis module, which is analyzing data and techniques for how we do that, and a bit of practice analyzing data. In the more straight physics side of things, we have modules in, again, our really core research areas. So magnetism, superconductivity, and how those are applied in the world around us. So developing technology that is used in hard drive storage, magnetic storage, but also we have a group that is nano 3D printing, or 3D printing nanomagnetic structures and analyzing them, studying those. We have people who study the quantum theory of solids, and again, we teach that in the fourth year, and how semiconductors are fabricated, how they are made. And then the low dimensional semiconductors are devices which are one dimensional, two dimensional, and the properties of the devices can change there. The way the materials behave can change as well. To support students, we also have a student mentor scheme. Last year, we had 17 mentors with 5 mentor consultants. They ran over 100 sessions, supporting 142 first-year students. They're an awful lot, and it was greatly valued by the mentees. So these were more senior students supporting first years in their first semester here. And that can be tips for the course, but it can also be tips about living in Cardiff in general, being an undergraduate at university, living away from home, and so on. When applying to Cardiff, you need to think about which physics-based degree you're interested in, but don't worry too much. Because there's a common year to most of our undergraduate degree programmes, you take the chosen path at the end of your first year. The decision on BSc or MPhys can be made at the end of your second year. So you can make that, regardless of which course you come in on, you can make that decision later on. And the decision on the professional placement is taken by the end of your first year to give you time to study for placements or apply for placements that will take place after your second year. The standard entrance grades are AAA to ABB, with alternative offers for those with only maths and no physics A level if you're unable to take A level or you were unable to take A level at your school or college. If you're studying the Welsh Baccalaureate, that's equivalent to an A level at the corresponding grade. And there are equivalent offers as well for International Baccalaureate for students studying BTECs and Access courses and other international qualifications as well. There are scholarships on offer for those who get AAA at A level or equivalent and have us as firm choice. More info on that on other slides and online. If you want more information about the applications, then do visit our Course Finder pages. In terms of finances, the university's tuition fees are £9,000 per year, and there are financial awareness talks for all undergraduate students. This is the first time most students are living away from home. As well as university scholarships, which provide £3,000 over the course of your degree for those coming in with three A grades at A level or equivalent, and being a firm applicant, there are physics scholarships as well. So there are not quite to the same financial sum, a few hundred pounds at a time, but every year the top performing students get a small prize. Bursaries are available to help with the cost of studying at Cardiff for various students in various circumstances. Do check the website at cardiff.ac.uk/fees for more information. Careers from Cardiff or careers from physics in general are very, very, very broad. There are students who can do an awfully large range of careers. We produce physicists who are very good with numerical skills. They can code, they can use computer code, they can express themselves in written and verbal communication, and they can apply the knowledge they've learned to a huge number of different problems. So we have students who go on and study at all sorts of companies. Typical destinations are the vast majority of our students end up in full-time work or further study. We have a few who after 6 months after graduating are still travelling or unemployed or have refused to answer the survey, although we think that's because they work in places where they can't tell us what they do. In terms of where they go on to work, we have students who work about three-fifths go into professions, so that's things like the financial sector, another sector where further training is often required. About a fifth go into industry, so that can be the aerospace industry, it can be the automotive industry, the European Space Agency, for example, it can be the electronics industry, or even things like Hawkeye, the company who make the machines that measure the tennis balls at Wimbledon. In terms of the public sector, where about a fifth of our students end up, then there are people who work in patents, in the intellectual property office. There are people who we believe go and work for places like GCHQ, although I don't think they can tell us that. And then there are people who go and work in HMRC, so that's the tax office, the National Health Service, other government sectors, taking the skills they've learned and solving them to very, very large problems that affect a very, very large number of people. And of course, there are people who go into teaching as well. If you want more information, you can go to our website at cardiff.ac.uk/physics, or you can email us at physics-admissions@cardiff.ac.uk.